So notice the duality. It's something that your typical Christian is not willing to face. So it's going to be hard to face it. But here's the duality. On the one hand, yeah, you want everybody to be saved. And it's a natural thing to want to be nice and say something nice and, how you want to call it, be encouraging, to try to defend somebody. And on the other hand, they're scum. Both things are true at once. Now, God has never minced words about this. The nice side is really nice, and there are a lot of verses about that, you know. God will protect you, God loves you, la la la. On the other hand, I'm going to clobber you. You will suffer. I will make you suffer. Very lurid descriptions in Scripture about how that suffering is going to work. And then the Lord himself didn't mince words either. Don't throw your pearls before swine, calling unbelievers and believers who are negative to doctrine, calling them swine, meaning unclean, fit only for slaughter. That's pretty, you know, uncomplimentary. And of course, your typical atheist is gonna bring that up.
Well, how nasty are you? What, are you better than me because you're a Christian?
And of course, a lot of Christians are stupid enough. They're swine too.
Say, well, I'm a Christian, so I'm better than you.
No, you're not. That's not what it's about. If you aren't positive to the Word of God, you're swine. You're disgusting, vile, only worth being trampled on because that's what you're doing to the Word of God, you disgusting person. And the Bible says that. You're just swine. You know that what it is about pigs? The place where they shit is also the place where they eat. They can't tell the difference. And your typical Christian is just as disgusting. Yeah, the unbeliever too. But the Christian more so, because you're saved and you're spitting on Christ. Now, as you start to learn Bible doctrine, you start to realize how true all this is. And as you could see from the tone that I used, which is not, I wasn't faking it. As you can see from the tone that I used, there's a lot of irritation and anger there. And your typical wimpy, disgusting Christian is going, well, you shouldn't be like that. That's not being a good Christian. Yes, it is. Because it's Jesus Christ himself, I think you can call Christ a good Christian, who said, don't throw your pearls before swine. KJVO, swine. Calvinist, swine. Catholic, swine. Baptist, swine. SDA, swine. Jehovah Witness, swine. They're all disgusting swine. Because they spit on Christ 24/7. With their vile lies and their false doctrines, saving no one. Of course, most of them are probably not saved either. You can't even get the gospel right, honey. I'm not sure you're saved. Now, I've established the disgusting part enough, haven't I? I mean, I'm not lying or faking the attitude. It's a real attitude. But it's God's attitude first. That gets left out of the pulpits because they're disgusting swine. They don't cover this side of it. Now, God being God, He wants to save even the disgusting swine who spit on him all the time and count themselves holy. Like he's supposed to reward them. Yeah, their reward is that they're going to be, you know, out in the back reaches of heaven, far away from him, tending to whatever is the equivalent of swine herding. Because that's all they're good for. See, that part of it doesn't get a whole lot of play. The swine are busy trying to tell you that if you don't do good deeds that they value, that you're going to be judged by God. Because to them, it's all about good deeds, not God deeds. Because God doesn't mean anything to them. So they're swine. Unclean food. Fit only for slaughter. Now, as a ruler, as a Christian growing up, really, truly growing up in Christ, you're like in the 1% minority. Surrounded by 99 swine per 100 believers, or per 100 who call themselves Christian anyway. And you have to get to the point where you hold that view, because it's the truth. Out of every 100 people who call themselves Christian, there's only one who's even in the spiritual life. Talk to 100 people who call themselves Christian. Ask them how many of them use 1 John 1:9 daily. Half of them will tell you that, well, that's only for unbelievers, which means they don't know the verse at all, which means that they're swine. If you call yourself a Christian and you're not in fellowship with God, you're swine. You're actually worse than an unbeliever. So, the attitude that you have to end up having as a growing believer, on the one hand, is to look down on. Properly, truthfully, look down on all those other Christians. Because they are swine. Don't throw your pearls before swine. Many an unbeliever is actually more objective than your average Christian. They're not a believer yet because by their standards, whatever their standards are, they don't see the evidence of God yet. But a lot of them aren't willing to just throw out the idea of God just because they don't see the evidence. They might be hostile, they might not, but somewhere in the back of their minds, there's a certain openness. I've encountered that a lot with atheists. They talk tough. But when you get them one-on-one, it's another story. A lot of that talking tough is because they're trying to defend themselves against a secret desire to actually believe. But they've been hurt in their minds. They've been hurt. So they're talking tough to cover up that pain and secretly peering beneath, waiting for a good reason to believe. A lot of them are like that. I'd venture to say 90% of the atheists are like that. They really want to believe, but they're afraid to, because they've been hurt the last time they believed. Whereas your typical Christian is already so full of himself. He doesn't study, he doesn't know, he doesn't care about the Word of God. He cares about turning it into some crusade so he can pat himself on the back. Well, then don't talk to them. You cannot have a conversation, an objective conversation with most Christians. It's not possible. They're so hung up on their little tenets. They can't reason them out. They can't think about them. It's got to be their way or the highway. And when you try to point out, we'll see if you say it's 3 days from Friday to Sunday, that doesn't work. Well, they'll come up with all kinds of fakakta nonsense, and if you don't agree with them, well, something's wrong with you. Okay, but 1 + 1 is not 3, ever. Friday afternoon to Saturday afternoon is 1 day. Saturday afternoon to Sunday afternoon is 2 days, but he rose at dawn. So that's what, 1.5 days. That's not 3 days. That's half of 3 days. Matthew 12, 40 and 41 says 3 days and three nights in the grave. That's 3 days and three nights. But they are swine. So they trample over that verse. And you got some so-called scholars saying, well, see, it's not a whole day and it's not a whole night. Never mind that you can't go from day to night until the day is over. And then from night to the next day until the night is over. I think Jesus Christ knows how to count. Especially since he's using the same nomenclature as in Genesis 1. There was evening, morning, 1 day. So you see, you can't talk to the Catholic. That's pearls before swine. You can't talk to the Calvinist who says, oh, you know, limited atonement. When you're in hell, you're paying for your own sin. I thought I was going to die the first time I heard that on YouTube. Calvinists think that you go to hell and are paying for your own sins then? So why did Christ go on the cross? Oh, but see, it was a waste of his payment if anybody that's going to hell he paid for, but they're in hell. Really? And who got paid for sin? Father. So why wouldn't Father get paid for all sin, whether we believe or not? They can't figure that out. So it's like swine talking to them. Just, I gave up talking to Calvinists or Catholics. You're just talking to swine. You're just talking to pigs. The same thing with the Muslim. The same thing with the guy who's telling you how great Windows 10 is. The same thing with the King James only person. Swine, all of them. Now, that's not a very kind thing to say. But it's the fact. And if you spend and waste your time like I did way too much of, talking to those people thinking like the liberals do, oh, if I could just reason with you, it'll be okay. No, you don't reason with Sennacherib's children. You shoot them. You kill them. You don't reason with the Muslim. You shoot him, you kill him, you convert him, you get him away from you, and the way you do all that is you ask God to do it. Because I can't tell one from the next. How do I know which one is on the verge of converting to Christ? Because some of the Palestinians have done that. Very few. But their lives are far worse than your typical believer. The guy who's the son of that Hamas leader who converted to Christianity. Walid Shubat and his son. The other guy who was in terrorism who wrote some book. See, a lot of these people who were, you know, devout Muslims, see all that criminality and they start to question. Well, why would Allah need this? Yeah, well, a real God wouldn't. A real God does not need you to go killing in his name, period. Okay? Period. Doesn't need it. And in fact, if you investigate the Old Testament, God told them, kill everybody. But here was the kicker. You have to always understand the satire in the Bible. God said, kill them all, but like a month beforehand, they were supposed to announce. and talk, like the 7 days marching around Jericho. Well, that was preceded by a couple of weeks. Hi, we're coming, understand that we're coming. So by the time they got there, you were really hardcore if you weren't listening. You were swine. And the only way to talk to swine is to really spank them hard. So we'll walk around for 7 days, and then the walls just fall down by themselves so that the swine know that it's not Israel who caused it, but Israel's God. And honey, if you ain't gonna believe at that point, then slaughter's the only thing left for you. To inoculate and protect the few who are going to survive the slaughter, because they'll convert, you know, like all those people we had with Rahab. They'll convert. Now, Islam is a sort of satire on the satire. It is an ongoing war rather than just the entry into the land kind. The whole book of the Quran is a satire on Exodus. One day, hopefully, I'll have time to prove that. But the point is, they are swine. You have to learn to think of them that way, because otherwise you'll waste your time trying to save them. You can't save swine. They have to go through the swinish process themselves. They already are so far gone, they can't distinguish between the place that they eat and the place that they defecate. That's what swine are. So you walk by them. You ignore them. You bypass them. You denigrate them, and you deprecate them, and you ignore them, because they're not worth your time. Now, to your average dumb bunny disgusting Christian who should be deprecated, denigrated, and ignored,
well, that's not being a good Christian.
Fine. You go right on being the hypocrite that you are, and then when we're both dead, we'll see who God rewards, okay? Because there's no convincing that person. It's just like the liberals. I mean, the Republicans and the conservatives are really not much better than the liberals. They're both out to, you know, control you. But the Republicans got one doctrine right that the liberals never get right. The liberals want to turn government into Santa Claus. And they know that that's not true, but that's a way they can gain power so they can gain money from you. The Republicans know that the only good government is small government. And while they want to take your money too, they want to take it with small government being in control. Yeah, that's what you want, because no matter how much you spend your money or how you spend your money in the private sector, you will be helping the poor. But once you got big government, no matter how you spend your money or how you save your money, you're not helping the poor. It's going, too much of it is going to big government, which eventually, you know, turns into like socialism. There is no real thing such as communism. That's just a pipe dream. That's swine, too. Every attempt that's made at, you know, communing, which is in Acts 5, when Peter tried to do it, and, you know, back in Athens 5 centuries prior, whenever that happens, all that ends up happening is tyranny. It's done in the name of the common good, because it's swine analysis. So you have to regard these people as swine. You are going for upper class, godlike thinking. And God knows this is swine. And he admits it. And so Christ told the disciples, do not throw your pearls of doctrine before the swine. Just walk away from them. They are unclean to you. That is love. because that way they're falling on their own faces and you didn't help. See, when you talk to somebody who's too far gone, this is why, you know, God does the thing he's doing with Satan. Satan is too far gone. There's nothing anybody can say to him that's going to change his mind. So God is using his own conflict, Satan's own conflict, to save the rest of us. Satan's basically being allowed to do whatever he wants because there's no way to talk to him. And let him do what he wants. God already foreknows everything he's going to do. And God's going to use that to save somebody, or to help somebody, or to bless somebody. Meanwhile, all the damage that Satan is doing, he's doing to himself or to those who buy into what he sells. Okay, so then they're damaging themselves. You're not helping. Now, that's a hard thing to live with. It's like triage. I don't know how familiar you are with triage, but triage is basically a bunch of medical people in the middle of a battle, and you got a bunch of wounded come in, and you have to decide, because you got limited manpower, who you're going to operate on, who you're going to help, and who you're going to ignore. And of course, the ones you ignore might die or get sicker. You have to decide... What patients can you treat that are most likely to recover so you can put them back on the battlefield? And the ones that you're least likely to be able to help, you don't. That's love. Okay? It really is love. Because, and especially here, because the Christian who's not going to listen, then... Every time you interface with that person, all they're going to do is use the interfacing that you do with them to get more nasty and more negative. And that's why somewhere, I forget where Paul said it, but when you got a recalcitrant believer, you warn him twice and then you walk away. Once or twice and then you walk away. James has a similar thing in, what is it, James 4 or James 5. And what was that? 1 John 5, verses 16 through 18. Verses 16 in particular. You're not even supposed to pray for somebody if they're too far gone. That's pretty bad. Now, that's one side of it. So what that means is that you distance yourself. You put them down. You put them out. You ignore them. You distance yourself. And you don't pretend that it's something other than what it is. They're scum. Period. You admit that. You notice that. You yourself need to be inoculated from their contagion. They're leprous. And the only one that can help them is God. And even he's standing off because they don't want to be helped. They want to be what they are. And they would like it very much if you were infected like them. So you stand off. You have to take care of your life. So you're living vertically toward God, and that is your relationship to life. In practice, that's really how it works, is you live vertically to God and just screw everybody else. They don't count. They don't matter. They're scum. They're swine. And the reason why you have to sort of look at it that way, which sounds so cruel, is that 99% of the time it's true. Your default attitude has to be screw you. God matters. Everybody else, fuck you. Excuse my French, but I gotta really make that clear. That's basically your attitude, which sounds just like what, you know, all the bad people think. But when you look at how Christ talked, that's pretty much the way he's talking. God I believe in, God I want, you don't want him, I don't want you. Now, you can't always be like that. You got people in your family, you got people who are co-workers, you got friends, acquaintances, so you're stuck with them. But you can mentally distance yourself from them. You have to put them down in your mind, lest you be tainted. Paul talked about that a lot. You know, in 1 Corinthians especially, because that was the problem the Corinthians had. Put them aside. Ignore them. Because you're going to be tainted along with them. And that's basically the problem with the whole liberal mindset. It wants to turn God into sugar daddy. Yeah, and you go down that road, you'll be like Balaam. You have to be tough. You have to have a negative attitude towards your fellow man and fellow believer. Now, after that is established, we're going for sequence now. God first, screw everybody else. Third thought, okay, how do I get paid, Dad? For this moment, I'm stuck in this disgusting body with this disgusting life and all these disgusting people around me. I need Bible doctrine to pay for my time. And why is that a useful thought? Because you do. Because it's true. Because how is God getting paid for you if there isn't Bible doctrine coming out of it? So if it's going to pay God and make it worthwhile for God to watch you live because you're scum too, then shouldn't the scum get paid? So how are you getting paid with what kind of Bible class am I going through right now talking? I'm talking into a tape recorder. What am I getting for that, Dad? Because if I'm not getting Bible in my head, being built line on line, precept on precept, there's no point to being here. Because, yeah, they're scum, and I'm around them, and I'm stuck with them, and I don't want to throw my pearls before swine, because my own Lord says, don't do that. Okay, but aren't I swine too? I'm swine to myself. I can't stand looking at me. So what kind of Bible doctrine is going to build up and make this worthwhile, Dad? Why? Because Dad's turning us all into fit bride, line by line, precept by precept, person by person, swine by swine. See, so now we got the flip side. Where's the Bible class information that's going to turn the swine that's still left in my soul to? Into something fit for you to look at. Into clean food. Because everybody around me is disgusting. Okay, but I'm disgusting to myself as well. So where's the Bible to pay for all this? Okay, well, now that I'm finding Bible to pay for my own swine soul, and all these other swine souls that I'm stuck around, and I got a body that has to be, you know, related to them. Well, where's the Bible doctrine to pay for the things I got to do to spend the time on all the crap I got to do in this body? Oh, well, here's Bible doctrine. Well, now this thing I had to do for so-and-so who's swine and scum. Well, now the Bible doctrine paid for it, so it's worthwhile. So now you really are beginning to look at things through God's eyes. Because that's really what he sees. And yeah, by the end of it, we're all dead. We're presented faultless with the exceeding joy. That's in Jude. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power forever and ever in Jesus Christ. Okay, but that's not now. So that's what you got to look forward to. Okay, these scum are not always going to be scum. Just get them to believe. At least get them to believe he paid for their sins. And you're just standing around, kind of like a Buckingham Palace soldier, waiting for somebody to ask you. Because until they ask, they don't want to know. If they don't want to know, there's no point in telling them. It's not like the gospel isn't known. It's never properly stated. But if you just volunteer it, they'll think you're trying to sell them on it. Because they're swine. So they treat you like swine too and trample under anything you say. So then wait till they ask. And say nothing. God's saying nothing. What's the point of talking? They're not going to listen. There is no point in telling Microsoft how disgusting Windows 10 is anymore. They've had 6 months to realize how bad it is. Actually, a year and 6 months. Are they listening to anybody? No, they haven't listened to anybody in 15 years. So you don't talk to them anymore. You don't buy what they got to sell because they're AKA .MS / MSA paragraph 3 is Hitlerian, imposing on you a code of conduct in order to justify slurping all of your private data. Well, then they're not going to hear you complain. They want to take your data from you and cause unending problems to you and them. But until they get hit with it, they're just going to trample your data under the dust. They're pigs. And they want you to be one too. And when it's time for them to be slaughtered, then you will be too. So you can't talk to them. So what do you have to do? Stay away from the pigs. And when they're hurting, maybe they'll say, well, gee, maybe we designed this the wrong way. Duh. But until they're hurting, ain't gonna do no good. Muslims, pigs, all of them. No point in talking to them until they start to question. And occasionally, you know, one out of a million will. Well, but that one out of a million is precious to God. So your life is vertical, and you and everybody around you is just flat scum. That's side one. Side two. Well, then there's got to be Bible doctrine to pay for this. Where is it? Dad, where's the doctrine that you taught me in some class? Have Mom, the Holy Spirit, send me the doctrine, John 14:26, so I can recall it and compensate for this horrible moment that I'm down here on this planet. You need to be paid, Dad. Something in my soul's got to be thinking, Dad. So where's the Matthew 4:4 always occurring, Dad? What doctrine do I need to be thinking now while I do whatever I'm doing with my body to compensate you for the fact that you're looking at this swine here? Not to mention all the swine I see with my own eyes, too. And then when you start to do that, it's like, oh, change. Change. And then you see why it's true love. Because all those swine are going to be dead someday. And they're going to be bragging about how they were swine, but God saved them anyhow. But they got no doctrine on top of that. That's all they'll have as the truth that they can talk about. Because all the swinishness in them will have been, you know, erased. And the only truth that they've effectively learned their whole time down here was they were bad, but God was good, and he saved them. And that's all they're going to know. At that point, Matthew 4:4 always occurring, all the doctrine you learned, they need, and they'll get from you, and they'll actually listen to it for a change. So it's true love for them to look down on them. It's true love for them to ignore and bypass them. And it's just true love for them If you say, Dad, okay, what kind of doctrine should I be thinking toward you? And screw them. You're storing it up down here toward God vertically now. And you will become a repository then. And then, horizontally, they will want to know. And then they won't be trampling it anymore. So that's what you do now. Screw them now. So that God will be making love to them through you then.